But we're going to have, we want to bless them and see those families blessed through clean clothes. Amen. It's Father's Day. Wow. How many of you, when you were a kid, used to brag on your dad? My dad can beat up your dad. How many, like, don't raise your hand if your dad was, you know, not that tough and you couldn't do that. But I had good farmer dad. I could always hold my own in the dad bragging category. There was some kids bragging on dad, and one said, you know, hey, my dad is so good. He writes some words on a piece of paper, gives it to somebody. They call it a poem. They give him $100. He's like, another guy said, that's pretty good. But, you know, my dad, he writes some words on a piece of paper. He's got camo pants and a man bun. And he calls it a song. And they give him $1,000. And the third one looked and said, that's all impressive, but you wouldn't believe this. My dad, he puts some words on a paper. He shows up, kind of reads them off, and they take four or five people to collect all the cash. They call it a sermon. So there's my dad joke of the day. So since we're in the vein of picking on the musician, there was a dad. Maybe you've been through this. I have drivers. If you've been through the driving phase, the son kind of came of age, actually was off to college and asked for permission to use one of the family vehicles. So the dad, in good order, just said, look, I'm willing to work with you on this, but I have a few requirements. One is you got to take care of the car. You got to take care of yourself. You got to go to class and get good grades and work hard and keep your hair cut. Well, the son goes off to college. He takes the car. He takes care of himself. He gets good grades. He goes to class. He gets up in the morning. He goes to bed at night. He's doing good, except for he has his long hair. So he comes home, and dad asks him about this. What's going on? He said, well, I mean, sometimes your kids have these smart aleck remarks. He said, well, Jesus had long hair, so I'm trying to be like Jesus. And the dad said, now that's really good, son. Jesus also walked everywhere he went. All right, sorry. Had this message on my heart several weeks ago, and I've been really excited to talk about this. It's called The Father's Blessing. The Father's Blessing. And in 1 Peter chapter 1, just a little introduction, it says something about all of us that's amazing. In 1 Peter 1, as he starts this letter, he says, to God's elect, strangers in the world. So he's talking to us as believers, God's elect. I want you to know that, because what he says in 1 Peter 2 is this. 1 Peter 2:9, you, so who is the you? God's elect, strangers in this world, scattered throughout. That's all of us Christians, right? To you Christians, he says this, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into the wonderful light. You are a priesthood. See, in the old covenant, we had the Levites, we had the priesthood, we had a select group of people. There were prophets and priests and kings, and I've got great news for you. When you became born again, when Jesus ascended into heaven and you were adopted into his family, now he says, guess what? You are now the priesthood. You are adopted joint heirs with Jesus, the King of Kings, and you are a holy priesthood, a royal priesthood in the Holy Family. Isn't that amazing? So I give you that because we're going to talk about something from an Old Testament perspective that in that context was the job of the priest. So we need to understand that now, today, 2022, that's our job. The job of the priesthood becomes our job as adopted siblings of Jesus, as joint heirs with him, and as a royal priesthood. So in the book of Deuteronomy, I may just spend some time meditating in Deuteronomy. There's good stuff in there. You really should read Deuteronomy once in a while. And it says, it has weird stuff in the Bible. You ever read weird stuff in the Bible? You know, if somebody dies and nobody knows who killed them, you take a heifer and go butcher it, you know, to make atonement. So hopefully you don't have to deal with that. But it gives some insight to the priesthood. In verse 5, Deuteronomy 21:5 says this: the priests, the sons of Levi, shall step forward when you have this kind of mess on your hands, right? Somebody died, you don't know who did it. The priests, the sons of Levi, shall step forward, for the Lord your God has chosen them to minister and to pronounce blessings in the name of the Lord and to decide all cases of dispute and assault. So it says the job of the priesthood is to pronounce blessings over the people and to serve both the Lord and the people, to help in their problems, to serve the Lord, to hear from the Lord and share with the people, and to hear from the people and share with the Lord. To pronounce blessings and to get involved in the needs, the daily needs of the people, to be a help. That's the job of the priesthood. Aren't you glad that Pastor Bob, that doesn't mean the pastor? That's not what Peter said, is it? To you, the elect, you are a royal priesthood. Now you're all quiet. You were all happy when you thought it was my job. It is our job as the children of God, the royal priesthood, to serve people, to serve the Lord, and to pronounce blessings. See, there's parts of our Christian life that we have delegated to professional leadership, to our pastors, that God never intended to be delegated. They were intended for us to do as believers. Now, specifically today, I want to talk about fathers. See, we are all a royal priesthood. But I believe fathers have a special privilege and a special calling to be leaders in their homes, to come under the authority of Christ and to represent Christ to their family. Not to lord over their family, but to serve their family and to pronounce blessing over their family. This doesn't mean, because who's the priesthood? All of us. So your children and wives can serve and pronounce blessings, but I think there is a special privilege and opportunity and responsibility of the father to lead in their home in serving the Lord, in serving the family, and pronouncing blessings. So let me give you three ways that we can, fathers, I'm just going to speak to you today. Everyone else, just listen in, because you can do the same thing. But I especially want fathers to think about the opportunity you have as the priest of your home. Three ways fathers can provide blessing to their families. I hope you're taking notes today. Write this down. Number one, seek the Lord for His blessing. Seek the Lord for His blessing. See, Matthew says this, Matthew 10:8, he says, freely you have received, freely give. See, what comes before giving? See, men, we should be seeking the Lord for His blessing in our life, for His wisdom in our life, for His anointing in our life, for His favor in our life, that we might have something to release to the people around us. There's an interesting passage in the book of Exodus 35. It talks about Moses, and he used to take this tent out to the outskirts of town. They called it the tent of meeting. Creative, isn't it? And he would go out there and meet with God. And it said periodically he would walk out to the tent, and when people would see him going out there, they would all stand and go to the door of their tent. They wanted to watch Moses meet with God. And he would go into this tent, and in that time, in that old covenant, out in the wilderness, that cloud representing His literal presence would move and go right over that tent. And then they would talk. It said like a friend would talk to another. That's pretty amazing. That tells us we can talk to the Lord. And then the cloud would lift and Moses would come out. And all, you see, he would meet with God, so he had something to give to the people. That's a big picture of what we can do in our family. We can meet with God that we might have something to give to our family. Seek the Lord for His blessing. In Acts chapter 3, it's this great story. Peter and John are going to the place of worship. There's a guy begging, and right, and he's wanting money. And they said, sorry about your luck, buddy. I'm broke. That's kind of what they said. They said, we don't have any silver or gold. Do you remember what else they said? But we do have something better than silver or gold. How many, if you were lame and could not walk, how many think total healing would be better than silver or gold? So Peter says, I don't have that. I don't have gold. But what I have, I give you in the name of Jesus. Get up and walk. What I have, I give. What did he have? He'd been with the Father. He'd been anointed. He'd been filled with the Word of God. He had faith and confidence and authority and power. He said, I got something. And what I have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus, get up. Your job is to meet with the Father and bring something back. You know, I had this picture of a hunter, like you're going out and you're bringing back some food for your family. You're going out to the garden and you're bringing in some provision for your family. Take that mindset, man. I know you can get your mind around that, right? I'm going out to the lake and I'm bringing back some fish for our house to eat. How about this? I go to the mountaintop to meet with God and I bring back some manna from heaven, some word from the Father, some anointing, a gift from God for my family. Pastor, I don't know how to do that. That's for all you spiritual type. I just wandered into church today and I don't even know what you're talking about. It's not that complicated. What did Moses do? He just went to the tent and said, hey, God, I'm here. And God met with him. God wants to meet with you. It's not this mystical, strange thing, and it's not for the selective few. You remember who the priesthood is? You. Say that with me. Say, I am a royal priesthood, chosen by God. God speaks to me. He does. So we need to seek the Lord for a blessing. Number two, we need to speak over your family words of blessing. Speak over your family. All right, men, now listen. The first part was like quiet. You could get away with that if you're the quiet type. And I know most of you are not the quiet type except when it comes to like spiritual stuff, right? We're not quiet when we're talking about things that go fast or make loud noises or shoot projectiles. We're not quiet about things that hook onto our fish line or find their target at the end of our arrow. We're not quiet if it combusts diesel fuel or gasoline and propels at high rates of speed. So I know you're capable, but a blessing in its nature is something spoken. So we're going to stretch you. We have to speak words of blessing over our family. See, Proverbs 18:22 says, life and death are in the power of the tongue. Life and death. You have that privilege. Matthew 16:19 said, I give you the keys of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. You have the authority and the ability to release something amazing through your words. Isn't that amazing? Now, this is where we're going to go into this Old Testament blessing. Numbers chapter 6. I bet most of you have heard this somewhere, sometime before. But what you didn't know is that it was your job. It was your part of your job description. Numbers 6:22 says this. The Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron and his sons. They were the priesthood. Okay? Who's now the priesthood? A royal priesthood. Right? In case you didn't know, you've got a little something on Aaron. The priest, right? You are a royal priesthood. You're actually adopted into the family of God. Amazing. Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. By the way, sorry for the distraction. Last week we looked at the Lord's Prayer, and Jesus said, pray something like this. Right? Here is a way how you should pray. Interestingly, this is Old Testament. You can bless in other ways, for sure. You can use your words to bless. But this particular blessing, interestingly, he said, this is how you are to bless Israel. So it is kind of prescriptive in this case. Like, this is a good blessing just to take, borrow out of the Old Testament and speak over your family and over others. And so he said, this is how you're literally supposed to bless the Israelites say these exact words: the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. So they will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them. They will put my name on the Israelites and I will bless them. Anybody ever watch Star Trek? Anybody not want to admit that Dr. Spock had a greeting? Come on. Who remembers it? You know what he said? Live long and prosper. Why did he do that? There does not have to be an explanation because it's Star Trek and there's no explanation required. But there is one because his name is off screen, Leonard Nimoy, and he came from a Jewish heritage, and he grew up going to synagogue, and the priests would stand at the portion of the service, and they would, I can't do it with my left hand, but they would do both hands, the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he turn his face towards you and give you peace. And so he'd seen this. And it was a non-scripted part of the show, came out in the second season, and he just came out with, live long and prosper. But what he was pulling out was something that stemmed from the old covenant priesthood, something that's still practiced in synagogues and Jewish blessings today. And it's pretty interesting, and I just throw it out there because Star Trek's fun. But I am not a Hebrew scholar. I would love to be because it's an amazing language, but I do have some tools to help study and learn. And there is can we put that on the screen, that image? There is a letter of the Hebrew alphabet called Shin, like your shin, that thing. And it would be a far cry to call it a W, but it kind of has that idea. And so when the priesthood there would do that, it would kind of represent shin. And why would they do that? They would do it double, both hands. They had to practice that. I can't. You get 1.4 blessings from me. The Hebrew letter shin. But listen to what our letters, function for language. But in the Hebrew alphabet, letters represent numbers. And letters have pictograph or pictorial representation, and letters have profound meaning just behind the letter itself. And the word shin represents either flame of fire or fire that is in the coal, fire in the coal. If you've ever grilled, it's like when you light the coals, charcoal, that's the real way to grill. You didn't know that. Okay. When you light the charcoal, it's on fire, but then it cooks down, right? And when you're actually cooking on the charcoal, you don't see very much physical flame. But if you feel it, it's hot. And so the fire is in the coal. Like, you don't see it, but if you grab that coal, you'll know. And so that's kind of the picture, is a coal that's red hot on fire. The fire is in the coal, or just means the flame of fire. That's what shin means. But it also, as it relates to God, represents the word Shaddai, God Almighty, El Shaddai. And so when they would represent shin, remember it said, I put the name of God upon you? El Shaddai, God Almighty, the one that's full of fire, the one who has the fire in the coal that is blazing with fire. See, on the tips of that, they keep putting them away from me now. There's another, it's an interesting little letter in the Hebrew alphabet. There's 22, but this other little letter is called Yod. And I'm not a Hebrew guy, so if you don't correct me, it'll hurt my feelings. But it's something like that, Y-O-D, Yod, Yod. The little tips of that are kind of like, it's almost like an apostrophe, but it also looks like a flame. So it's just that little upper thing, and it actually shows up in all 22 letters, but it also has its own letter. And it means this, the fiery hand of God. The fiery hand of God. So the shin, fire in the coal, is capped off with three fiery hands of God. And to me, I think there's three fiery hands of God called Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. that kind of goes with the blessing, right? And so I'm putting the name of God and the fire of God through the fiery hand of God when I speak the blessing of God. Now, last thing on my sidetrack rabbit trail, just because it's fun. What happens when you blow on those red hot coals? So if you take the blessing of God and the name of God with the fiery hand of God, and then you release the breath of God upon that blessing, what happens? You fan the flame. Isn't that awesome? There you go. You just wanted to know that today. So when you bless, we do this a lot, just stick our hand forward, but that's why they do that. But I want to give you this blessing real quick. If you're taking notes, I would write this down, five elements of this blessing, because you are the royal priesthood. And you can take that same hand and count them off. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The Lord bless you and keep you. Means favor, protection, and provision. It's a picture of like Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd. He protects me. His rod and staff, they comfort me, but he leads me to green pastures. It's the blessing and the keeping. It is the favor and the protection as well as the provision. May the Lord bring provision into your life for what you need, blessing. May the Lord protect you from the enemy. May the Lord protect you from attack, from invasion, from temptation, from evil. So it's this blessing of the Lord's protection and provision. May the Lord be a good shepherd to you, watching over you. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. What's that sound like? A smile. May the Lord smile upon you. That's a good thing. It just means favor and approval. I remember when Jesus was baptized and God looked, the heavens split, the dove comes down. You remember what God said? When the heavens split, I think that was his face shining upon Jesus. Because he said, "This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased." He smiled upon Jesus. Good job, kid. Isn't it great that this was not before any miracle, before any dead person raised, before he walked on water or calmed the seas or called any disciples? God just said, "Good job, kid. I'm proud of you." He let his face shine upon him. What a blessing. So may the Lord be a good shepherd to you. May he bless you and keep you. But may God just look at you and smile today. Sometimes we get this idea that God's mad at us or God's grumpy or God's got lightning bolts or he's going to judge us. No, God is smiling over you. May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you. Number three, be gracious unto you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. What's grace? Grace is a gift. It is unmerited favor. It's God saying, even if you don't deserve it, I'm going to take good care of you. Everything we get from God is a grace gift, healing and deliverance, salvation. We are saved by grace. We come into his kingdom by grace. We become a child of God by grace. We get healed by grace. We get his provision by grace. Sometimes we feel like we're pretty good. Sorry to tell you, probably not good enough. But sometimes we feel pretty rotten. That might be accurate. And the great news is God doesn't operate on that scale like we do. God looks at you and says, "You're my kid. And I love you. And I'm going to take care of you anyway." Grace. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the grace of God be manifest in your life. What is that? May healing be manifest in your life. May God's abundance be manifest in your life. May God's wisdom be manifest in your life. May the favor of God manifest in your life. Isn't that awesome? Blessing and keeping. Smiling at you. May the grace of God rest upon you. Number four, may he turn his face towards you. This is attention. This is different than smiling. Kind of similar. But smiling is approval. Turn his face towards you is attention. Now, I have four daughters who are amazing. And all four, I think at some stage of their life, have done the same thing to me because I'm a dad who can get distracted. And so when they're little and you're talking to them, playing with them, and they'll do this. They'll grab you by the chin and say, make you look at them. You ever have a kid do that to you? Now, I've got good news. I think God is paying attention to you anyway. But what a profound blessing to say, may God turn his full and undivided attention towards you. Right? May he turn his face towards you. Isn't that what that means? May God give his full and undivided attention to what you're dealing with right now. Wow. May he take good care of you. May he provide for you. May he protect for you. May he smile upon you. May he give you gifts of grace. And may he give you his undivided attention. Then he says, right? Peace. Peace. May he turn his face towards you and give you peace. That's the Hebrew word shalom. It means to be whole and complete. It means lacking nothing. Here's the beauty of God's peace and the bummer of God's peace. The bummer is it doesn't mean necessarily that nothing ever goes wrong. What it does mean is no matter what's going on, God gives you that wholeness and that peace and that fullness. He's with you in the storm. He's with you on the mountaintop. He's with you in the valley. He's with you in the struggle. He's with you in everything you're going through. Shalom, peace, wholeness, no matter what's going on around you. News is not that exciting these days, right? It's just depressing. So don't bother, right? The economy, the leadership, the government, and yet we can have absolute peace. You might not have peace about your 401k. You might not have peace about your investment. You might not have peace about interest rates. But in the midst of all of that, God can give you this supernatural peace. Isn't that amazing? Teenagers in the house, God can give you peace. Young adults in the house, God can give you peace. Toddlers in the house, God can give you peace. Stuck with your husband in the house, God can give you peace. Why did that hit home so much? Shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious unto you. Turn his face towards you and give you peace. What a powerful blessing. So, number one job, we need to seek the Lord for blessing, for me to receive. Number two job, and it's not limited. You can speak other blessings over your kids, but this is a good place to start, to speak this blessing. You can add to it. You can, but use it as a foundation of blessing. Spoken. Pastor, that makes me uncomfortable. Write it down. Read it. Read it out loud, though. That's okay. Take your sermon notes today. Fill them in, if you forgot, and stuff it in your Bible and go home and speak that over your wife. Speak that over your kids. Speak that over your home. Speak that over your workplace. Just a little side note. If all you do is complain about your boss in your workplace, you are cursing them. You are using your words. Life and death are in the power of your tongue. If that jerk boss is, and that's the nicest thing you say about him, you are not helping the matter. You are releasing negativity and pronouncing, right, dysfunction over your employer. So I'd recommend blessing. If you want to keep that job and you want a promotion and you want your business to prosper so you can prosper, just a little aside for you. Now there's one more. Receive blessing. Seek the Lord for a blessing. Speak words of blessing. Number three, serve your family as a blessing. Did Jesus do this? Yeah, he met with the Father regularly. He walked in the favor and blessing of God, but he spoke blessing over his disciples. He taught, he spoke, he preached, he released words of encouragement and favor and healing and victory, but he also served, right? He demonstrated that. He took the towel and washed the disciples' feet. He fed them. He led them around. He taught them. He was responsible as the rabbi for their care and their well-being. He served them. Now, here's what's interesting. Remember who the priesthood is? We are. The priestly blessing is saying, the Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you and make his face shine upon you, right? May the Lord be gracious to you. Now, here's what's interesting. Who's our best example of a father? Our Heavenly Father. So if it works for him, and it worked for Jesus, this is also a way, not only do we release the blessing of our Heavenly Father upon our family, but we can do the exact same thing we're speaking for our family. Bless and keep. What's that? Provide and protect and take care of my family. So not only do I release God's favor, but me as a father bring provision and protection and care, shepherding over my family. Make my face grumpy when I get home from work because it's been a long day. No, smile upon my family. Approval. May I show my family approval and joy and satisfaction. Like Jesus, the Father said to Jesus, I am well pleased. Fathers, we have a great privilege, and sometimes we need to correct, and sometimes we need to direct, but also it's really important that we smile upon our family. Let them know your approval. Blessing, keeping, let our face shine upon. Be gracious. What's that mean? Sometimes we need to give better care than people deserve. It's a gift. I don't always want what I deserve. And sometimes I do want what I don't deserve. And we're asking God to be gracious. What a principle to model, to show grace to our family, to show favor upon our family, to give what is not always earned or deserved. To turn our face towards our family. In other words, attention. Oh, man. Let me tell you, dads, after a long day, a long week, a long month, after a lot of stress and worry, and after being responsible for things, sometimes we don't always give our attention at home. And we're saying, Lord, turn your face towards them. What a good reminder for us. Give my undivided attention to my family when I'm with them. Turn my face towards them. And yell, shout, stomp, and be grumpy. Demand. Rule the roost. Wear the pants. Or speak peace. Bring peace. And there's a time for discipline. There's a time where we have to have conversations. But understand the blessing is what we want in our life and what we want over our family's life is the peace of God. So, dads, we also need to be the agents of peace. When we come home, we bring the one of the references in Scripture is the aroma of Christ. Now, sometimes some of you have an aroma. I'm not sure it's Christ. But there is a presence, not only physically, but when you encounter somebody, there is a presence about you that this is a godly person, this is a peaceful person, this is a pleasant person, or you've all encountered that person where like you just start backing up because they're just grumpy. They're ornery, they're in a bad way. I would just rather not talk. I'd rather not encounter because you're an unpleasant person to be around right now. The aroma of Christ or the stench of death. We have the privilege of bringing peace to our households. So our job, it's a big job, isn't it? Now, ladies, listen, you are priesthood too. So we are joint heirs with Jesus. We do this together, but I do think there's a calling upon the Father to step up in leadership, but there is the gift for all of us to be able to speak blessing, to receive blessing, and to serve as a blessing. What would happen if we all brought that to the table in our households? So I want to pray for us today. I want to ask you to bow your heads, and I'm going to invite, are you having the whole worship team? Just Cam? Just a couple. Okay, we're just going to sing this song in a minute, but I want you to just take a minute in reflection. I want to ask two things this morning. I know a few things. I know for some of you, you're like, yeah, that's a fun sermon. The shin thing was pretty cool, Pastor. I've heard all this before. That was nice. That's okay. And for some of you, you're like, that's just weird. I've never heard of that stuff, and I don't know what Star Trek has to do with Jesus, and I don't even understand any of that, and who cares about Hebrew? I get that too. But what I want to share is it starts with our relationship with Jesus in a growing relationship. That is the moment of adoption when we become adopted into God's family, joint heirs with Jesus. And that's when what the Bible calls being born again. Like, we start here as human beings. We get the privilege of being adopted as immortals, children of God, forgiven, brought into God's family. Isn't that amazing? With that comes the ability to have an anointing of God and to be able to speak blessing and to be able to bring peace and to be able to minister. Starts with a relationship with Jesus. If you're here today and you're not in relationship with Jesus, you could start today. Everybody has a first day that chooses to follow Jesus. And that begins that walk with Jesus of learning and growing. And if that's you today, would you raise your hand and say, I want to start with Jesus today. I want to know Jesus in a personal way today. I want to know that my sins are forgiven, that I've been adopted, that I am in God's family. Amen. Lots of folks online today. We want to pray with you as well. Would you pray with me, church, and especially those that are responding today? Just make this prayer out loud. It's a good practice for the blessing. Because remember, life and death are in our words. So pray with me. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me. Thank you, Jesus, for giving your life as a sacrifice for my sins. Today, I surrender. Today, I make the choice to follow Jesus with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my strength. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I want you to just do two things. We're going to take time to sing this song called The Blessing. And I want you to think about two things. Maybe how you can be a blessing. Maybe this is a challenge to you. I appreciate that. I haven't always been a pastor. I haven't always stood up front with microphones. There were days where I would have said, are you kidding me? But I think we could come today and say, Lord, I want to be the husband, the father, the grandpa, the great-grandpa, the uncle, the guy next door that is a blessing to the people around me. I'm willing to try this thing. I'm willing to work on it. The other part is, I need a blessing. Remember what it was? Seek the Lord for a blessing. I need healing. I need favor. I need the peace of God. I need strength. I need wisdom. I'm a train wreck right now, and I just need God to pour into me so I have something to pour into others. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I want to pray for a couple of things in our church that need blessings, and then we're just going to move into this time of altar time and worship. But Penny McClanahan was having a real chronic back problem this morning, so Sean just left to take her to get looked at. So we want to pray for Penny. And Josh and Dina Griffin had a few things happen, but first a flood, kind of a flood on the second level of their house, but then a fire in their kitchen that did smoke damage throughout the house, which left them now to where they're out of their house for at least 3 months is what's projected. And so we just want to pray over them, and then we're going to just move into a time just seeking the Lord. But Father, we thank you that you're healer. We thank you for the grace of God. We speak that over Penny right now, over that back. We call that back into order. Relief of inflammation and pain and whatever's going on in that back, we speak over that. The blessing of God, the grace of God, the favor of God. We just declare wholeness over that body. Over Josh, Dina, over their whole family. Lord, thank you that everybody's healthy and good. But they're in a challenging season, and we just speak favor over them. Your abundant provision, your peace, your wisdom, as they adjust and adapt to different housing, as they work through just logistical changes, as they work through the insurance companies and all those aspects. We just declare favor, supernatural favor, Lord, your spirit to guide them. Bring, Lord, we talked about peace today. They're in a storm, and we speak your peace over them. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Would you, if you're able, would you stand? Let's just begin to worship the Lord together, and I think all sides that are appropriate. Lord, I want to be a blessing. And maybe today, Lord, I need a blessing. Feel free if you want to come to an altar, if you want to move to an aisle, if you want to move to the back, if you want to stay in your seat. But let's just take a little time and worship the Lord today.
Lord, bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Children and their children, may his favor be upon you in a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and the children, and the children. May his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, around you. He is you, he is with you, he is for 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 you. Amen. Amen. Children, the children. May his presence go behind you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you. He is for you, so for you. He is for you. He's for you. He's for you. He's for you. Amen. 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 Amen.
Jesus. 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 Thank you, Lord. 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 Mighty God. Amen. Just a couple quick things. We're going to go. Pastor Bob, I'm going to give you a little warning, but I'm going to ask you to just to bless the congregation. Father of three mighty men, grandfather of a whole flock of kids, I want to ask you to bless us as we go. Before we do that, make sure you grab beef sticks and root beer or other waters, other things we have there for our men today. We want to bless you. Make sure you make plans to join us on Saturday, picnic and graduation party, and prayer and worship on Wednesday, prophecy class 6 to 7, worship and prayer 7 to 8. When we're done blessing today, we have prayer workers that will be available. We'd love to spend time, so we're going to take conversations to the foyer and eat meat and drink root beer and converse. So, Pastor Bob, would you close our time?
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this opportunity we've had today to worship you, to hear your word, to sense your presence, and just to show our love to you. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunities we have in this body. And Lord, we just ask your blessing upon each and every one here this day, especially the men, the fathers, but we ask your blessing on each one. Lord, we just pray, Lord, that you would just anoint and touch each one. Even now that we would sense your presence, we would hear your voice, and we would walk forward with courage and boldness that you've called us to be priests, that we're all a part of that priesthood. So, Lord, use us powerfully. As we walk out these doors, help us to understand our responsibility to you, our Lord and Savior. And Lord, that we would speak your words wherever we go, and we would live the life that we are to live. So we thank you, and we bless each one here this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song.